Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
All right, T Radio V Inside Metal Show. What you're hearing there is a brand new Black Star Riders. And speaking of Black Star Riders, we got the man, Robbie Crane,
hey.
The new bass, I guess we could call you new bass player for
absolutely.
Black Star Riders,
yeah.
And Black Star Riders manager, an old friend, Mr. from back in England, and what was it, 90, I think we first, 93, I think it was, and we first met. Adam Parsons, very long
good
time ago, manages Black Star Riders, managed Thin Lizzy for several years, and also currently managing Europe as well. And you got a couple other projects.
We got a brand new band called Tax the Heat from England,
right.
Who are going to be huge, and that we're just developing them, getting them a record deal right now, and they're touring around doing. They opened for BSR actually last year, which
great band,
was cool.
Great
and
bunch of dudes.
I heard a lot of great stuff.
Yeah. And they're doing some dates with Thunder in the UK,
cool.
And.
Still going strong, Thunder, huh?
Well, they kind of, when they get back together, because kind of split up for a time, and then they get back together. And Danny's
never made it here, but in England, I know
They're an amazing band, Danny's a good friend of mine, and we talk quite a lot, and they actually they're doing three arena-type shows. They kind of came back. I saw them last year. They do a Christmas show every year, and I saw them. They sold out 6,000 tickets last year, which was amazing. And they're coming back doing the arena. And I think they've sold out London, sold out Manchester. They're doing Leeds, Leeds, Birmingham, and London. Sorry, they've sold out Birmingham and London. So it's good. It's good.
That's
for
them. Awesome, man. Mm. That's awesome to see they're still doing
absolutely
so great.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and of course we had Ricky Warwick from Black Star Riders on a few weeks ago, and he did. Well, we didn't run the contest for him, but we are going to run the Betty's Garage contest, because I know my man Adam is an old school metal man, and I know you must know your metal. You grew up on the Sunset Strip before joining Rat. You've been in Rat for what, 15
years? 15 years.
That's a pretty good guess.
It's a heck of a run.
Yeah,
good
and then
times.
Just recently joined a Black. Black Label, Black Star Riders. How did that come about?
I had done a thing in Russia about a year prior to last summer, and with Jimmy DeGrasso. He had subbed for James Kotak in a thing with Kerry Kelly from Cooper.
Mm.
And I met Jimmy DeGrasso, we played together one time, and he kept saying to me, hey, do you play with a pick? And I was like, yes. And so about a year later, he texted me one day and just said, hey, are you available? And called me up and asked me if I wanted to audition. Mm. And at the time, I had been out of Lynch Mob for a while, and I didn't really want to do rock and roll. I was playing in a pop thing.
Right.
And I was like, not really, but I'll be courteous and do it. And so I downloaded the Black Star Riders album, and that hearing that record made me really go, wow, these guys are killer. And these are great songs, and it's something new and different. And I loved that they had a brand that they had built, the packaging, and I went on the website and everything. And you could tell that they were well managed and had a great direction, somebody that knew what they were doing behind the scenes as well as the music. So it just was appealing to me. So I auditioned, and I don't know how I got the gig, but I got the gig.
Well, he came down to see a show, and first time I'd met Robbie, and I said to Jimmy, I said, are you sure about this guy? And and of course Robbie's got the history, and it was the right, it would just fit in, and it was perfect. And to be honest with you, we had a couple of other guys, but I don't even remember. It was kind of when Jimmy mentioned Robbie, it was like, yeah, let's get him down. And first time we met, it was, this is it, if Robbie's up for it, let's do it. And it fitted. It was a seamless, Marco, you had wanted to do other things, bless him, we're still friends. I spoke to Marco last week, and he's great guy,
he's
great bass player.
It was
sad to see him go, but he wanted to do that. He wanted to, and we the whole idea with Black Star Riders, it's a band. It's not a project. When we first started, there was a lot of people that were saying this is a project, and of course it's not. It's a band. It's a, we're on our second record now, and we'll go on to the third and fourth. And the problem is Marco wanted to do other things, and we said, you're in this band. It's not saying that you can't do other things, but he wanted to, he's a busy guy. He likes working round the clock.
Sure, yeah.
So in the end, You know, Marco, it was Marco's decision to leave, and Robbie fit in, and it's been great, you know, and it's awesome. Been seamless, really. Yeah. And the fans have accepted it. It's good.
Well, it's good to be in something stable. I know Lynch Mob and Rat, they were kept going through. I know they had, you know, Juan was coming back in Rat, and then Steven left and came back, and there was all this. Yeah. What's with all the drama with all these 80s, you know, hair metal bands? I mean, it's crazy.
You know, the thing is that I've always learned, just in my experience with playing with, whether it was with Vince Neil in the early 90s or with Rat in the late 90s and into the 2000s and Lynch Mob or whatever, is you realize that these guys have had an amazing amount of success just because they're talented and they're good people, but they don't realize that it's the sum. Mm. It's the whole of the sum, you know, not just the individuals. Right. There's always, everybody thinks that they're as important, and we all want to believe that, but in reality, it's about the band. Absolutely. And I think the deal with Rat, and they all know this because I love those guys and my brothers, we talk all the time still, they just need to get out of their own way and just let, you know, Rat be Rat and play for Rat, you know.
Well, that last album, Infestation, was one of their best albums they've done in years.
Thank you.
That was
fantastic. Yeah.
And they're great time making it. Contracted to do another record for Roadrunner, right? Are they? Was that done? I've heard rumors.
No. We had a 2-album deal with that, and we recorded Infestation in 2009 with Elvis Bisquet, and it was a good time. We had a great time making the record, and Carlos Cavazo played a huge role.
Carlos is awesome.
Yeah, he's a, I mean, the dude's a legend. You know what I mean? And he's a great dude. And
he's featured in our movie with Snow. His old, you remember Snow?
Yeah, absolutely.
Before Quiet Riot.
Absolutely. Yeah. Wasn't that with his brother Tony? Was Tony in that? Yeah.
And Stephen Quadros.
Stephen Quadros.
Doug Ellison. Yeah.
Carlos is such a good dude, you know, totally. and he brought such a good element. Him and Warren played so well off each other, and they wrote so well together. I thought, you know, Juan and I always kept in touch, although I didn't know Juan prior to me joining the band, and I would always tell Juan, "Look, man, I'm leaving. So, you know, you got to get ready." And he would go, "Give me 6 months." You know what I mean? It was cool, man. Juan and I, you know, we always stayed in touch. And when I was ready to leave, I told him. And I, you know, the band was very cool about it. So I took a couple years off the rock thing. The BSR thing's been amazing. I had the benefit of going out on the road with BSR for about a week with Marco in the band, you know. And it was such a cool experience to be able to watch the dynamic of the band with Marco in the band and really get to, you know, when am I ever going to be able to go on the road with the great Marco Mendoza, you know? Yeah, it was just such a great experience, and who he is as a person, you know, it really gave me a great insight to be prepared for what I was coming into, and it really helped me a lot, you know, just being in that situation, seeing how these bands are outside of it and seeing why Marco left. I totally get why Marco left, but just to see how wonderful and how embracing as a brotherhood of the BSR guys were, for Marco going on to do what he was doing, you know, it's unfortunate that most bands nowadays can't do that or don't have the foresight to see that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Just to be,
absolutely.
We're human beings, and, you know, we play music as a passion. It's not a job.
Sure.
If we wanted to make money, I mean, we would go, you know, be accountants or be businessmen or do something else, you know, and it's a labor of love. And so from all these 80s bands, they just need to put it down and stop being so darn girly.
Absolutely. Well said. Well, you've worked with Vince Neil from Motley Crue, who we'll talk about in a minute. Mm. Of course, the guys in Rat, George Lynch. Mm. I mean, you worked with all the major, and you even started out with Poison, right? You were there as a
youngster,
right?
As about to begin 15.
With. Wow.
I grew up in Hollywood. Well, from Orange County, but I grew up in Hollywood, and I had an Ampeg SVT head that was my dad's, and I would play these gigs in this terrible band I was in when I was 15. And one of the crew guys from Poison came to the gig and was like, "We need to use that amp for recording." I was like, "What band are you talking about?" And it's Poison. I knew who they were. They were a club band.
Right.
I asked my dad. My dad said, "You know, well, you can loan it to them if you set it up and bring it home."
Right.
So that's kind of how, by chance, I brought this Ampeg head in, and you know, they used it. And I, you know, "Hey, maybe you can come to the next gig. Hey, maybe you can come to the next gig." So yeah, I was on tour with them. I guess I did their first record.
86.
Yeah. Well, I started in 85.
When they first came.
Yeah, and I worked with them. You know, I was in bands and stuff, but I would just help out, whatever. But I did, like, all the tours up until, like, about 86. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And then I was like, "Dude, what am I doing?" Mm. You know what I mean? I can do this myself.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I went home and just started playing in local bands. And
you played quite a few different bands in the L.A. area on the strip. Well, I used to remember seeing you around the strip.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it was my hometown. So, right. I mean, you look back on most musicians and you're like, you know, "Remember that band Lickety Split you were in?" Well, people are like, "Well, dude, you were in a lot of bands." I'm like, "Well, how many bands were you in when you were 15?
Right.
You know what I mean? Or 16, you know? But I was in about 10 or 12 different bands, you know. Mm-hmm. Growing up in Hollywood, you know, that's just what we did. We just played with everybody. I mean,
right.
We were just, you know, watched all of our bros. You know, I went to Fairfax High School, and that was what was going down. You were either into drugs,
right?
You know what I mean? A gang, or you were in a band, and so
or all three.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I was fortunate, man. Music definitely, you know, in our neighborhood, it was, you know, the guitar players were Saul Hudson, nice, you know, slap. Willie Conadu, Tracy Ulrich, which is, you know, Tracy Guns, yeah. and who else was the other dude? Mark Vachon, who, you know, those were the dudes, you know what I mean? And it was, and Hillel Slovak, and you know, sure, they all went on to greatness, and we would just watch those dudes and go, okay, that's how you do it. So,
right on, you know. Man. Well, the Vince Neil album, you did their album with Steve Stevens, right?
Yeah.
That's a fucking awesome album. Oh, that cool, never, man. Really, never really got much credit. I mean, I thought that was, some of Vince's best amount. Work. But yeah, it was kind of forgotten about pretty soon. But that had some great songs on it. And Steve Stevens plays great, better than ever. I mean, just
Steve, album. Well, I joined that band as a guitar player, although I'd never been a guitar player in a
band.
Oh,
really?
No, okay. I knew Vince through his brother-in-law, Gary, right. and Vince was like, hey, dude, do you want to be in my band? I was like, sure. I mean, you know, so I come down with my bass, and Phil Soussan was our bass player.
Right, right.
So I was like,
right.
Oh, he already has a bass player. What does he want me to do? And he's like, don't you play guitar? I was like, sure. So I had never played guitar in a band. So if you ever see the MTV Movie Awards in 92, that's like the first time I'd ever played live with a guitar in my whole life in front of a crowd. And I was just like, you know, nervous as heck. And it was, you know. But that's how I joined the band. But Phil was our bass player. Steve and I ended up going back and redoing the bass on the record. So as the record was done, I did it as a guitar player and ended up with Steve, predominantly Steve on the record playing bass. Mm. But I did, you know, we redid the bass on that record. And that was kind of my introduction into the whole scene. Right. Do you know what I mean? Ron Nevison produced it, which is an interesting thing to watch, just the whole process, you know. And I was a kid. I was 22, and I had no clue what was going on. But Vince and Steve definitely helped me immensely, and I'm very appreciative of that.
And then from there, you went to Rat?
I guess I was in Vince's band for almost 5 years. I did two or three records with him.
That's awesome.
And then a lot of touring, and then into Rat, like, 2 months later.
All right.
Yeah.
Very cool. Rat. Very cool, yeah. Well, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about Rat. We're going to talk about Adam. And Europe and a lot of the other bands you got going on. And like I said, we're going to be getting into Betty's Garage and the closing statement, but we're going to take a break right now. Close out with a little bit of Rat here. We're going to be back in about 2 minutes with Adam Parsons and Robbie Crane on Inside Metal T-Radio V.
I'm Sheriff John Bunnell. You're watching T Radio. Radio and TV? What?
That was perfect.
Yeah, no, why are you asking me to do this after 12 drinks?
Andy D on T Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D on T Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D on T-Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T-Radio V.
Wow!
So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts. Yeah, no.
What it do is your man Money B from Digital Underground asking everybody to check out the Going Way Back Show, your home for classic hip-hop, raw and uncut. Join me.
And me, DJ Always.
As well as Ty Teasy bringing you the old school new news every Tuesday, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, right here
on T-Radio V.
That's right, Radio MTV.
Zoe Williams.
And I'm Dr. Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zoe What Morning Show. You can find us here on TRadioV.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio NTV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
Hey, back there mumbling.
To them. To them.
T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Metal show with my guest Adam Parsons, manager extraordinaire, and Mr. Robbie Crane, bassist extraordinaire, on the Inside Metal show. And that was a little Europe we heard. Let's talk about a bit about Europe. I know you just started managing in the last couple years, right?
Yeah, we officially from 1st of January 2014, but we were involved for about 6 months before that.
Awesome, and they're going stronger than ever. Whole original lineup, John Norum back.
Well, it's the classic lineup.
It's
the final countdown lineup because they had guys in it before. The first two albums, different guys, but this is the
Ian on drums and
Ian on drums, Mick on keyboards, John Norum guitar, John Lennon on bass, and Joey obviously singing.
All right, and you got a new record coming out.
It comes out March the 10th in the US, March the 2nd in the UK. And then 6th of March in Europe, and we and various and 4th in Japan and everywhere else. And we start a tour, actually a co-headline tour in the UK and Ireland with Black Star Riders and Europe together.
All right.
Which is so we're the album, the Europe album is out the day of the first show in Dublin, and they haven't been to Dublin for 25 years, so that's awesome that we can do
that's
that
great.
And get them back. And we're doing a US run in April, first US run in 10 years. So yeah, a lot's going on.
And they've got so many great songs, and some of their latter stuff, and their earlier albums before Final Countdown, you know, the first album. And
I personally got into them as a fan when Wings of Tomorrow came out,
and then
I heard that the first, and then of course the Final Countdown just blew them
But it's funny because that's the only song people are so familiar with. I mean, I there's other songs, rock, you know, rock into
well,
the night.
I think everyone equates
Europe to that, and they're much more than that pop sound.
Well, it was a number one hit worldwide. Sure, I mean, absolutely. I think in America, I think it hit number six or something like that. But it was worldwide. It was number one, and it's one of those things where
still played at football games.
Yeah, it's still and it's on adverts, and it's on it's one of those things where. Most people that the uneducated about Europe think that all they've got is that one song. I mean, I speak to a lot of people, and I mentioned Carrie, I mentioned Cherokee, I mentioned Rock the Night, I mentioned Superstitious, and all these other tracks, and they go, okay, so they are more than the one. Right, but because, you know, it's like a lot of bands, when they have that one hit that is just mega, just unbelievably huge and continues, it's great for them, and there's lots of bands that would die to have that hit.
Sure.
But it's hard in a way because there's so much more than that.
Well, Rat's a perfect example. Everyone calls Rat a one-hit wonder with, of course, Round and Round. But you had, I mean, Rat in the day had tons of hits. I mean, MTV hits, you know, Lay
People
It Down.
People can't remember them.
Yeah, well, I mean, no, there's still Slip of the Lip, Lay It Down, Wanted Man, You're in Love. Yeah. I mean, there's so many hits. Do you think you're tough? Whoa. I could actually hear that go through the mic.
Michael Devon from Whitesnake.
Oh, take his call. Take his call on the air. Can you put on speaker?
Hello, my snake. How are you? You're on the radio show with me right now, Michael Devon.
What are you doing, Robbie Crane?
I'm in the middle of an interview right now, my man. You're on.
On the air, Michael Devon.
But I will call you back and brag about the orange gear, oven which I desire.
Where are you, in Ohio?
No, I'm in L.A. right now. I'm in an interview. I'll call you back.
All right, man.
All right, brother. Bye.
Bye.
Sorry.
The great Michael Devon from Whitesnake.
He's a good guy.
Yeah.
He's a good dude.
Very cool.
Yeah.
He's still playing with Whitesnake, huh?
They got Tommy Aldridge back in the band.
Who's playing guitar now? I know Doug is.
It's Joel Holstrid. Joel Holstrid. I called that, too. Kerry Kelly and I were like, who are they going to get? And I go, Joel Holstrid.
Who is he from? I know that name.
Joe was in Night Ranger for a while. Okay. He did. He still does. What's the Broadway show? The rock one. It's called the
Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he does the Al Petrelli thing. The orchestra.
Oh, Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Yeah.
Joel's great.
Yeah. Jeff Scott Soto does that as well.
Yeah. Talented player.
Huge, yeah.
Great guy. Real good guy. Deserves it. It's good.
Cool. Is Coverdale still living in Tahoe?
I don't know Coverdale, but I've heard yes.
Cool.
I don't know him. I just all my bros play with them.
That's awesome.
So I'm like,
that's
cool.
Awesome.
You know what? Whitesnake, one of those bands. I love Whitesnake.
Sure.
I mean, they just, you know, people have a go at David about his voice, and you know, but you get older and your voice drops.
Yeah,
but I've seen Whitesnake. So I they're one of those bands that they're on a festival, they're on a bill. To me, they're just, you know. And yeah. Tommy's a good friend of mine. I managed, obviously, managed him in Thin Lizzy,
sure.
And it was great to have him back. And I know Doug very well. And you know, and yeah. You know, when Doug went, I'm really glad that it's, you know, it's working out for David. And I think that you know, they've got the catalogue, they've got songs there. They make a great show. You
well,
know?
That show, I guess it's probably had to be about 6 or 7 years now. But they did that on cable TV. That live show, did you see that on Access or something? Mm. It was with Doug. It was with Tommy.
And with
it was
Brian Tichy on drums.
Oh no, I think it was Brian Tichy on drums. Yeah, but it was amazing. Mm. It was on one of those. Shows. It was in England. Like, it was like their first comeback.
Oh,
okay.
Oh, it's with Marco on bass.
Marco.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. No, that's great. Yeah. No, that's with Tommy and Marco.
Yeah, I've seen that.
That is great. Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah. And Coverdale sounds amazing. Mm. And they open up with Burn. And it's such an amazing performance. Yeah. So yeah, great to see those old 70s bands still doing it well. And speaking of Purple, I mean Glenn Hughes still. I mean, I see him every year at you know, at the Whiskey and doing stuff, and he's still got
amazing.
The voice.
Still
unbelievable. 65, 66, just however old he is.
Just inspiring for all of us.
Yeah, yeah.
We're all still just like, dude, Glenn is still ruling right now. You know, what am I complaining about? I better get up and run today because that dude is ruling it still.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. Yeah. So what else you got? I mean, you started as a booking agent in England.
Well, right? I actually started in this business 34 years ago, and I wanted to be a rock star, then I wanted to be a manager. That was the whole plan. It was even when I was... when I first started, that was my goal. I saw Song Remains the Same was really what started me. This bit was really what did it. I hit music kind of late at 14 years old. I my parents were not musical at all. Never even had a record player till we were 12.
Right.
And 14 was obviously watching bands like Sweet and Slade back in England back in the early 70s.
See, here in America, people don't know that. People are Slade, Status Quo. Who are these bands?
Oh, dude,
Sweet, Slade,
love
Status
those
Quo.
Yeah.
They were. They're still humongous well,
people know Slade God. Because of Quiet Riot,
right,
and they
right,
know
right.
Sweet because they think that Love,
Love is Like Oxygen.
Love is Like Oxygen. Sounds like ELO, you know. Yeah, so yeah. I mean, it's kind of it's a difficult thing, but
well, like, they did have some hit spots on the run.
It's true, but back when I was a kid, that was my first sort of, you know, Sweet and Slade were the two.
Sure.
Yeah,
and
sure.
Then I kind of got into, you know, in the late 70s, I started going to concerts and. I wanted to be a rock star. I mean, I started to play the drums because I couldn't play anything else, really, and that's what I did. And I wanted to get laid, and I wanted to be a rock star, you know. And then, but I saw Song Remains the Same, and I saw Peter Grant, and I thought, this is what I want to be.
What was your thought? Because I saw that when I was probably around 11, 12 years old, too, when it first came out in the theaters. My mom dropped me up at the theater, and it was like, I thought it was cool. I thought I was going to a rock concert. Yeah, I could see Zeppelin in the theaters.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, I grew up even at that young an age on Zeppelin and Sabbath and Purple.
Yeah,
and
me too.
What did you think of that when you first saw Song Remains the Same of the band?
Well, you see, I got into Zeppelin really when In Through the Outdoor came out, which is still one of my favorite albums, and it's because of the time it was. I mean, I don't, you know, people, it's arguably, you know, not their best record, but to me,
I would say they're worse.
Well, you see, I actually really like that record because it was, you know, it's like anything, you grow up at that time.
Sure.
You know, we're talking about the new wave of British heavy metal. I have bands come up to me now giving me demos, you know, that I was a big fan of when I was 14, 15, 16 years old, that they give me new stuff recorded back then. I go, this is shit.
Yeah.
But the stuff that back then was great
because
it was the time it was in.
Absolutely.
So it was, you know, I mean, the movie was cool. I mean, it was just a cool movie. And it was, you know, one of those like Tommy, like, you know, all these things. They're just cool movies, you know.
No, my point is, when I first saw that, because I used to think, you know, Zeppelin back then, you didn't have MTV, you didn't have any video. So these guys were gods. You saw them in the magazines, in Cream and Circus and Hit Parade or whatever, and you heard the stories, you know. You heard all the crazy stories about the Riot House. And
totally.
When I went to saw Song Remains the Same, that's what I thought. You were going to see these rock gods. And, you know, I mean, I didn't think you were going to see, you know, Robert Plant slapping some chick with a mud shark, but I thought it was going to be like this crazy. And then I went there, and I see, like, Robert Plant with his family and by the pond, and then, you know, John Paul Jones reading to his kids. I'm like, what is it? They're like regular people.
Yeah.
I mean, because back then, I really thought these guys were like God. I didn't
mythical,
think they were human,
mythical
gods. I'm like, and I just left the theater kind of confused. Like, I mean, I loved it. I loved the live performance. And I'm going, wow, these guys are just like
Well, I got out. I love the I love the Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, and awesome.
And the fact that Peter Grant was just this larger than life in every way figure, and to me it was just like, you know, this is what I want to do. So I decided, you know, I basically played drums in bands for a few years, got to a certain level, nothing at all, which to really talk about. Then I decided that through I kind of fell into being a tour manager. Kind of like, you know, you kind of help bands out, and then, but I was always managing the bands I was in. I was always the guy in the band that managed them. So I went up, and it just got to the point where I just got sick of playing drums anymore. I was like, I was working an 18-hour day before I got to the stage, from driving the van, you know, doing everything, you know, managing this band. And in the end, I got the opportunity to make money, more money than I ever did playing. And I thought, well, this is kind of cool. Plus, I was in tour buses now. Sure. I wasn't in vans and all that. And then I became an agent. Then I became a promoter. Then I basically done everything in the live music business for a certain period of time. Got very lucky in the mid-90s, was working for one of the UK's biggest promoters, and got sort of put into a position where I was sort of a talent buyer for them for a while. So I was buying Metallica, Iron Maiden, and sort of, you know, working on that sort of level of show,
right,
which was great. Then I've always sort of managed bands, but I kind of, you know, kind of fell into management really about 2000 as a full-time thing, stopped doing everything else, and solely concentrated on management. And then, you know, so yeah, it's you know, I wanted to do it at 14 years old.
Well, I want to talk to you about that, when you were playing in bands, because that was my favorite era of music, the new wave of British heavy metal, the early 80s.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, I grew up in L.A. I used to see all the L.A. bands at the time, from, you know, the first shows of Motley, the first shows of Metallica, and even Snow and all the bands you talked about before that. But I always, you know, when Maiden and Motorhead and Samson, Tigers of Pantang, Stax, and all those bands started coming out, it was like
Priest.
That was, oh yeah, Priest a few years earlier, of course. Yeah. But you were gigging around during that time, huh?
And yeah, I was playing in 20 billion bands. I mean,
were you playing with a lot of the new wave of British heavy metal?
Well, no, I ended up in 85. I got a call and I joined Paul Di'Anno's band.
Oh, I didn't know that.
That's big, dude.
And I was the first drummer in Battlezone.
No,
but then I got fired within a couple of months because I didn't realize that Paul had a drummer that was a million times better than me, that he'd already had in the band, but because he couldn't announce Battlezone, he was under contract with Di'Anno at the time, he took the band. He had Battlezone together, so the drummer he had went back to Denmark, a guy called Sid Falk, who was in, who did the first record with Battlezone and was in Overkill after.
Hmm.
And Sid was back to Denmark because he didn't want to wait around for Paul.
Right.
So I got brought in to basically rehearse with them. But to play with a guy like Paul Di'Anno after the first Iron Maiden album was
huge.
Is one of my favorite records ever.
Yes,
absolutely.
And, you know, so to play with him, you know, I became Paul's agent in later.
Was he hard to deal with as an agent?
You know, Paul is a great guy. I mean, you know, I've got nothing. I was pissed off when I got fired from the band.
Yeah.
You know, but at the end of the day, I became, you know, I'm still friends with him. You know,
Did you read his book before we go into a break?
I actually haven't, no.
Oh, you should read his book. I don't know how much of it is exaggerated, but.
Well, listen.
I know he likes to
tell
a story.
I'm saying this with the utmost love for Paul Di'Anno. I bet 100% is
it. It's got to be. That book is insane. If you read some of the shit he talks about.
He's a trip.
He's
one of my all-time metal heroes. So that's pretty awesome to hear.
Listen, I think Bruce is a great singer.
Totally.
But you cannot beat Di'Anno on that first Iron Maiden album.
And absolutely.
The first, even Killers, man. Killers.
I saw the Killers tour here in 81.
Wow.
When they opened for UFO, Long Beach Arena. It was like Paul Di'Anno live. Amazing. Yeah. We're going into break now. It looks like we're going to do a little break here on the Inside Metal Show. T Radio V will be right back with Adam Parsons and Robbie Crane.
Join Dave Navarro and friends for Dark Matter, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on T Radio V.
Dave Navarro here, Dark Matter Radio, TRadioV.com.
The universe is vast, enormous, huge, full of stars, planets, and matter. Some of the matter is so dense that not even light escapes.
Get on the mic, get on the mic, get on the mic, get on the mic, Frank.
Pardon my reach.
See, and you guys were worried. I think this is going great.
Pardon my reach.
Get the f*** away from me, dude.
You are really beautiful.
Oh, thanks, you guys.
He's one of the most beautiful people I've ever known.
This is pretty much every week. He brings in a guest that tells him how beautiful he is.
Pardon my reach?
If you have to reach over me, then don't do it.
He is the straightest gay guy I know.
Dave Navarro signing off. Dark Matter, thank
Good
you
night.
For listening.
Bye.
Dark Matter with Dave Navarro, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on TradioV.
Hi, I'm Bob Nalbandian, and be sure to watch my show, Inside Metal, which airs live every Tuesday from 3 to 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, right here on TradioV. I'm going to be bringing in the greatest heavy metal artist live right here in the studio. Once again, every week at 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, every Tuesday, right here at TradioV.com, Radio in TV.
Yo, yo, what's up, everybody out there? This is Crazy Bone.
I am the Bum Keith G.
And right now, you're watching TRadioV.com.
TV in radio.
Yes. Radio and TV.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. See? Okay, right, yeah.
TRadioV. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Down from the glen came the marching men with their shields and their swords.
All right, TRadioV Inside Metal Show. Awesome. I'm your host, Bob Nalbandian, with my very great guests, Mr. Adam Parsons and Mr. Robbie Crane. And we were talking a little bit about Thin Lizzy, that, of course, classic Thin Lizzy, Emerald. You kind of brought Thin Lizzy back. You were managing them during the John Sykes era.
For a while. Basically,
tell us what happened.
What happened was I wanted to put in a bid for them before they had a manager before me, Charlie Busco, who manages Styx now, and manages Skinner. And I wanted to sort of, I looked at them before that, but it just never happened. And then after Charlie parted with the band, John was in the band still, and it was John, Tommy, and Scott, and Francesco, the bass player, and I got to meet with Scott and flew out to Europe, had a couple of meetings with him and got the band. So the whole idea was from day one was to try and do a new record. Now, I went within 48 hours of getting the band. I flew to England, met with Phil's estate, the people that run Phil's estate.
Right.
And I was the first manager apparently to ever do that. And I said, well, you know, because the deal was done where Scott could use the name.
Right.
Basically, just as a fate, you know, because Scott's one third of the entity that owns the whole thing, but Scott could go out and tour with it and do all that as long as he never did an album.
Right.
And I went to have a meet with them because I wanted to get the business in line because I knew we were going to elevate the band. I knew I could get the band bigger.
Sure.
Well, to cut a long story short, John Sykes decides to leave for various reasons, and we then.
That was right before you had an AC/DC tour line.
It was a week and a half before we had three AC/DC shows.
Jeez. And that's a good time to leave, John. What are you thinking? Come on. I mean, I love John Sykes, great player, but sometimes
I'm not saying
decision
anything.
Making isn't quite the
that's
best.
That's why they're musicians, not businessmen.
Anyway, continue.
Anyway, so we took a year and a half. I went to Scott. I said, Scott, we got to get this. We got to get Brian Downey back in the band. We got to make this
absolutely.
As authentic as we can.
Yeah.
Which made such a huge difference.
Yeah.
No disrespect to Tommy Aldridge, one of the greatest drummers, but getting Downey back in the band, that was the Thin Lizzy sound.
Well, his feel. Well, just
yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So we went and got Brian, you know, went and got Brian on board. I got Darren Wharton back in. We're looking for a singer. And then Vivian Campbell had always been a Thin Lizzy fan, and
sure.
He had some time off with Leopard. We knew we'd go back at some point. We didn't realize he'd go back that soon, but we ended up getting Vivian involved. And then, of course, Marco had been in the band with Sykes, so we got Marco on board. And then trying to find a singer was tough. And a mutual friend of mine and Ricky's mentioned Ricky to me. Now, I knew the Almighty.
Sure.
And I didn't know whether... I wasn't sold instantly. I was like, I don't know, his voice is not, you know. So he said, well, he's playing, he's doing a solo acoustic show at the House of Blues,
right,
opening up for Cheap Trick next week. Go and see him. So next thing I know, Ricky emails me, and just, you know, we sort of correspond on email. Then I go to the show, and he's standing there with a flat cap and acoustic guitar playing Ace of Spades in front of this sold-out audience. And his voice,
great.
And I close my eyes, and I could feel his voice would fit.
Right.
Plus, he's one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. Yeah. He's amazing with the audience. Yeah. With no disrespect to Sykes, but his one fault musically is because he's an incredible guitar player, incredible singer, looks great. But John had no real communication with the audience.
Absolutely.
And I wanted that thing, with the band. So I went to Scott, thinking Scott would go, because we were mentioning various people for bass playing, guitar positions, and Scott would go, no, no. And I was about to mention Ricky Warwick to him, and I thought, it's going to be no, no, no. And then I go, Ricky Warwick, what does that mean to you? And he goes, I played on his solo album. So I thought, well, that's great.
Yeah.
Then, at the same time, Joe Elliott is remixing remastering the early Thinner Lizzy albums.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
You know, so he's on the phone with Scott, and he mentions Ricky, unbeknownst to any of us.
Right.
Ricky and Joe are best buds. In fact, Ricky was Joe's best man when he got married.
Right.
So Joe goes, he's the ideal guy.
Sure.
So then we set it all up before we even rehearsed. We announced it to the press.
Oh, really?
We had everything, and we never actually got any rehearsals. So I'm like, I hope that he can pull it off. So anyway,
he definitely pulls it off.
Yeah. So anyway, we all got together. Ricky had spent about a month and he still had his lyrics and everything. And then that was in the May 2010, I believe. And then we launched the band in the December. So from May to December, bless this guy, he spent 6 months, 7 days a week, holed up in a room, immersing himself in Thin Lizzy. So when he came out on the first show, which was January in Aberdeen, January 2011. We did a show. Did you come to the showcase?
I did, and thank you so much. Okay, that was one of the few shows that Vivian actually
played. That's right. He ended up doing a European tour and a US run,
right,
Vivian. And then Vivian went back to Def Leppard, and we got Richard Fortescue.
Amazing show. You know, such a great show. Private showcase, like 60 people.
That's right. Well, that was the first time. But then to play in front of a sold-out Aberdeen crowd, the show was sold out. That was amazing. And Ricky, I always going to be one of my best friends. Yeah. I mean, you know, and an amazing talent. And I'm so proud that, because when I first asked him at the House of Blues it was in the Foundation Room, House of Blues in LA. Mm. I said, do you want to sing in Thin Lizzy? And he was like, he was so nervous. He was so nervous about it. You know, really?
Phil was his idol.
What a pressure to put on. But bless him, he took the bull by the horns, and he's an amazing, you know. And I'll be honest with you, there's nobody else I think can do that job.
I agree. Black Star Riders going strong. Second album. When's the actual date? Is it out now?
It's out on. What's the US release? It's out the 23rd of February in the UK.
Okay.
And I'm not sure the US release date. It's within a week.
I think it's, a day or two after.
After it, yeah.
Nuclear Blast, of course. Is it a Nuclear Blast worldwide? Mm-hmm. A great, great label. Monty Connor.
Yeah, Monty.
Actually,
absolutely. I mean, to be honest with you, that whole deal came about because we were looking for the deal with Thin Lizzy.
Right.
We toured the band for a couple of years. Things were going well, and it was time to do the record. And everybody was kind of on board, but we always said with Thin Lizzy, if anybody at any point is not happy with it, we won't do it.
Right.
So, and at the 11th hour, that basically came out with a few people in the organization, and so it was fine. You know, we were okay with it. But I'd originally approached Roadrunner about the deal, and Monty, of course, I've known for years, and Mark Palmer, I've known for about 25 years, who's the UK guy. And Mark had approached me, and we were talking about it. And then with the corporate takeover of Roadrunner, Monty and Mark were out. And he called me and said, I can't tell you, but I'm going to join a label. I'll come back to you. So we kind of put that on hold. I was doing some other labels. And then he came back to me and said, I've got this new label. They want to sign Thin Lizzy, but it's not a label you would associate. And I want you to just bear that in mind when I offer you the deal. So to cut a long story short, we end up doing the deal with Nuclear Blast, and because of Monty and Mark, really.
Right.
And then when the Black Star Riders thing came out, bless them, again, they came to the table. We used the same production. Kevin Shirley was going to do the Trinity album. So we did the same thing. And I have to say, and I'm not trying to be funny when I say this, they've been an incredible label. I mean, absolutely. You know, we couldn't wish.
Yeah.
And actually, the first album.
It's so funny, these independent labels. I remember when Nuclear Blast and Century Media and all these labels came out, and even Roadrunner. Back, I used to work at Roadrunner in the early 90s. I ran their LA office for a couple of years, 91, 92, and nobody took it serious when you went to the magazine. You're not a major label, or none of the radio stations would take it. And now it seems like the independents, especially when it comes to hard rock and metal, are doing way better.
We're in a great position right now, because just before this, at the end of the first album cycle, before Killer Instinct, you know, while we're recording it, we recouped on the first record. So, which is really, as Jimmy DeGrasso said to me, in his 30-album career, and Ricky Warwick's 15, 16 albums, they've never recouped.
Yeah.
So we're in a position. But me and my business partner, Ace, who handles a lot of the BSR stuff as well, you know, we can go to the label, and they're very, very accommodating with most things, which is a great position to be in, you know. I mean, if you recoup, then it means the label's made a fair bit of money.
Yeah, which is very rare after the first album. I mean, how many major label albums? Yeah. A lot of bands that have won gold and platinum, you know, they have no money. I was like, didn't you recoup? No, we still haven't. You sold 500,000 albums. Well, we still haven't recouped them.
It always seems to be the major labels. You know, I've done them for Warner Brothers and Columbia, and those have never recouped. But all of the minor labels, so to speak, have always been
quite smart. Right now, the labels haven't got the money to do what they did back in the 80s.
That's right.
So they're very, very, and that's what another thing I like about Nuclear Blast, the deal that they offered us, the fact that we recouped at the end of the first
cycle.
It's a cycle. Means that they got it right as well.
Absolutely.
They offered as exactly the right advance.
Yeah.
They've made their money. We're happy. And
that's
we're,
what it's
and,
all about, man.
You know, so it's great. I mean, can't say enough.
Label should have had that philosophy years ago.
And it's great to see a label, and Adam is absolutely correct, they're so accommodating. They're so excited about the new record, as we all are. I mean, everybody seems so excited about it. Monty's a great guy, and everybody at Nuclear Bass has really worked hard to get the band to where it's at right now.
Right on, Adam's
with Adam at the helm.
Well, cool. Looks like we're going to go into a break. We're going to do the contest, Betty's Garage, coming up. You ready, Adam? You ready, Robbie?
I guess. Yeah.
Let's do it. Betty's Garage coming up next. Our final segment of the Inside Metal Show on T-Radio V.
Hey, hello, this is David Faustino, and you are watching T-Radio V. Do you see what I'm saying? It's television crossed with radio. It's all together. It's weird. Radio's in the middle of it. It's amazing. You're watching it. Go.
Love and marriage, love and marriage.
This is Quick Fix Radio.
Quick Fix Radio.
Yeah. Check it out, y'all. We back in the building. What's going on?
Yes, sir. What it do? We got some super guests, super special guests up in the place,
in
man.
The building. We got all five live in the building. Bone Thugs in the building.
All
everybody.
Five here, live here, in the we house. We up in here.
Tonight, y'all.
Not
what's going on?
Hey, man, I had to come see what this TV radio, what this all about. You know what I'm saying? Hey.
We got Game on the line. Game, what's going down, baby?
What up, man?
What's going on? Oh, man, we got EPMD on the line. Who's this on the phone with us?
Yo, what up, man? It's Akon.
Oh, Akon in the building. Akon. Who is this on the line?
It's Be Real.
We got Be Real.
Be Real.
What else we got on the line?
This is Ty Dolla Sign right here.
What up, Ty Dolla Sign in the building. Man, thanks to all the fans for stopping by.
The Quick Fix with Crazy Bone, right here on T Radio V.
Out of the
ocean and grew legs and they started walking and the apes climbed down from the tree.
Hey geeks, wake up, we've got big news. I'm not gonna mumble this time. Geekscape, the long-running movie video game. Let me do one more. Hey geeks, we got big news! Geekscape, your favorite show about movies, video games, comics, and TV, is coming to TradioV Monday, October 6th. And it'll be on every Monday from then on, 7 p.m. Until the apocalypse happens, we're all eaten by zombies.
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
All right, T Radio V Inside Metal Show. I'm your host, Bob Nalbandian, with my very special guest, Mr. Adam Parsons, manager for Black Star Riders, and of course, Mr. Robbie Crane, bassist for Black Star Riders. So being in Black Star Riders now, of course, you grew up on the Strip. You're an L.A. boy. You know, born and raised pretty much in L.A. On the Strip, playing with so many bands, played with Vince Neil for many years, played with Rat for 15 years, as we just said, George Lynch and Lynch Mob. And then, of course, before, with all these different L.A. bands, touring with Poison as their bass tick as a kid. So growing up around this L.A. scene, now being in Black Star Riders, very Europeans, you know, coming from the roots of Thin Lizzy, basically a very European Irish sounding band. How has that changed musically for you?
It's interesting to see how the European side of metal or the rock musicians, how they take it so differently. You know, in the LA based bands, it was always, as we said before, we joined bands to get chicks and whatever most people do. It was nice to hear Adam say that because he's from England, knowing that they that they were doing the same thing. I'm like, oh, Zeppelin did do that. Oh, okay, cool. Because for us, it was like, how are we going to get chicks? Well, I'm not going to wear cabarichis and carry a radio and do dancing or whatever, that break dancing. I want to get in a rock band. So coming from where we came up in Hollywood and stuff like that, it was interesting to see the different, culturally, how different Black Star Riders is for me. You know, Ricky being from Ireland and Scott being in England for 40 years and Damon Johnson, from Alabama. I mean, he was like legendary. Sure.
Brother Kane.
Yeah, man. I mean, we knew of them, but we never met any of those dudes,
Right.
And my experience in the band has just been pretty much just join the band, come out on the road for a week and meet them, and then go out and tour for a couple of months and then go make a record with them, which is cool. It's generally been what I do. But it was interesting to see it from a different aspect with these different people. I mean, DeGrasso, I mean, he's been in a million bands. And,
sure.
Jimmy's from the States, so I kind of get Jimmy. Like, it's right. Cool. But Damon, he's like, dude, what's happening? I'm like, is that for real, dude? Like, I make it more than it is. But it's just interesting to see how they approach music so differently than most LA musicians and how they seriously do take it serious, and the bus isn't full of a bunch of idiots, know what I mean? It's just really cool to see how they really take the music seriously and how they really are appreciative of where
it was amazing when Damon joined Thin Lizzy, because I got he was in Alice Cooper,
right?
And we basically did a show in when Richard Fortus was in Thin Lizzy, we did a show in Dublin, Ireland with Def Leppard, Alice Cooper, and Thin Lizzy. And so Vivian was playing with Leppard, Damon was playing with Alice, and Richard was playing with Thin Lizzy at the time. So awesome. all three of our guitar players in Thin Lizzy were on the stage with different bands that night, which is funny. So we knew because when we got Richard in the band, we offered Richard the job. He said, oh, Guns N' Roses not doing anything for at least 2 years or whatever. So we said, okay, because we didn't want to go through the Vivian Campbell thing again.
Sure.
So we got Richard in, and Richard was awesome, and and then, of course, he did one summer tour with us, and then Axel made the call.
Right.
So he had to go back, and which we understood. So it was we were looking at other guitar players, and Damon really from that show stood out, because we were talking to him backstage, and he just told us what an amazing Thin Lizzy fan he was.
Sure.
So we called him, and I said, but the problem is you've got to give up Alice Cooper. And I said, you want my opinion? Don't do it. Right. That's a great gig for you.
Yeah.
But I want to offer it you because, you are the right guy.
I'm on the spot.
So anyway, he ended up, me and Ace spoke to him. And I actually was trying to convince him not to do it, even though I wanted him in the band.
Sure.
I thought, this is crazy. We can't offer him, at this point, you know, we haven't got the album out. We don't know what we're going to be really doing. Anyway, it kind of worked out for him. So it was just one of those things where he, you know, just from Alabama, this guy that was such a huge Thin Lizzy fan.
Sure.
Because Thin Lizzy were never that big in the States. They were an underground thing.
True.
But having him involved, and he totally... You know, I mean, Scott was just, Scott likes guys that almost know Thin Lizzy better than he does.
Yeah.
It's a, you know, confidence thing. That's why, you know, the guys that we had, that's why Vivian came in. Yeah. Vivian was a huge fan, knew the stuff.
Sure.
But Damon has just totally, has been amazing in this band. Yeah. Really amazing.
Well, we're going to have to get right into Betty's Garage because we always get cut short on it. So let's get right into the contest. No more stalling. Don't try to stall this.
I'm nervous about this.
He's on to us.
All right, we ready? We get it all queued up, Frank? Let's go with song number one. Well, let me give you a, we'll do about 10, actually about 15 to 30 seconds of each song. And it's mostly guitar riffs or leads, and you got to figure out what band and what song if you can.
Let's see what.
All right, you guys ready?
Heavy Metal Love. Oh, no.
Let's do it. Go ahead, Frank. Again.
Metallica.
Oh.
I know that bass sound.
Come on, Adam.
I know that bass sound.
New York band.
It's not Anthrax.
Yeah.
But it is Anthrax.
I was going to say, it sounds like.
From the Among the Living, I Am the Law. That is Anthrax. All right.
Give me that bass sound.
Yeah, Frank Bello.
Yeah, yeah, great.
I love that. Eddie Kramer produced that album, actually.
He did John Corabi's first album with The Scream, too.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That is true. Did you plan that?
No, John Alderetti.
Oh, okay.
Juan Alderetti.
Ah, yes. Yeah. That's right. So song number two. This is one for Adam. Very underground 70s. Any idea? Very underground prog band from the 70s. They featured a member of the Yardbirds.
Well, that's telling a lot.
Did I play this whole song? We could fade out. Does it fade out? Oh, okay.
Give me one more clue.
All right. They only did one album before this singer had a tragic fatal accident. And they were kind of going to be the next big super group. But the one album was very underground. In England, I think it was quite big. That's why.
And they were English.
They were British, yes. You remember the band Armageddon?
Of course.
That's Armageddon.
Wow.
Keith Relf.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Got electrocuted on stage, I believe. Yeah.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
Did
he or die? In rehearsal. Yeah, he died.
Oh,
and that was the end of the band. And Martin Pugh, a lot of great musicians in that band.
That's terrible.
Yeah,
that's
great, great album. Very underground if you could find it. Armageddon. So track number three. You ready, Frank? Let's do it. For you, Adam.
You're putting me on the spot. Hey,
you got Frank Beard tie hats.
These new wave of British heavy metal.
Very Peter Bolton bass.
That sounds like it. All right, the vocals were just about to kick in. We just talked about the singer.
Okay.
Is it John Bush?
Nope.
No. Oh.
No.
Okay. Good. I'm not familiar with the song, but the sound is very familiar. Give me a little.
Okay. They Iron Maiden used to open up for this band, and they have a very commonality. Is that a word?
What Whitesnake?
With Iron Maiden.
Well,
the members.
With
several of the members.
So it's Paul Di'Anno.
No. Judas Priest, UFO.
No. A new wave of British heavy metal. This is going to take forever.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yes. Samson.
There you go. Oh, Samson. Paul Samson.
I have that record.
Yeah, great album, Shock Tactics.
Yeah.
Bruce Dickinson on vocals.
Yes. I just got that album.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody sent it to me.
Great album. I love that album. All right. Samson. Remember, number four, right?
Yep.
For you, Adam. If you don't get this, somebody's going to be very upset.
I know the song. Hold on.
Motorhead?
I actually have this album.
Ooh, somebody's going to be very upset.
Can I just say it already?
Yeah.
Europe.
No, it's not you.
No. Sound like John Norum.
No.
It's a Swedish guitar player playing on that
track. Ingvae. Oh, is it Steeler?
No. I have this record.
You were one of the first bands you worked with, Adam, that I remember.
I have the record.
The first tours you booked in England.
Lizzie Borden.
There you go.
Okay.
Appointment for death.
Of course.
Lizzie's
there you go.
Be very up there. And that was Jonas Hansen on lead guitar.
No wonder I have the record. I have the record. And
yes. I thought I was making this easy for him.
He's got so much going on.
Do you know what? It's like, this is why I this is why I became a manager. I failed in school. I knew what I was doing. When it came to exams, I just couldn't do it.
Well, I do make this challenging. This is kind of tough. You ready for the next one? All right, we got 2 minutes left. Let's see. You might know this, Robbie.
I would.
L.A. band.
Malice.
No, good guess though. Very big L.A. band at the time. Huge.
Racer X.
No. Before that. Hmm. During the Motley era.
Okay.
Snow?
No.
Hold on.
It's not Wasp.
I'm actually,
yep, there you go. Oh, yeah. That was the Torture Never Stops.
Yeah, Torture Never Stops.
I think we played that on a previous episode. Yeah. I don't remember. But yeah, Torture Never Stops.
I saw the Wasp. Blood Drive show at the Troubadour.
Oh, that was awesome. Yeah. I was there.
And I had the benefit of playing with Chris in a few things in the past 5 years. He's great.
Yeah. I love the guy. Yeah.
Good dude. I really do. Great guitar player.
He's in the movie, by the way. We got hopefully we'll be able to finish this off. We got next song. Classic 70s band. That first album influenced so many. This is actually from their second album, but
it's not Humble Pie.
No.
Pat Travers.
Close. No, we're in the same kind of ballpark.
Guitar
player, Bay Area guitarist.
Y&T?
No. Just Y&T. Before Y&T.
So from the 70s.
From the 70s.
Montrose.
Yes, there you go. Montrose, I Got the Fire. Of course, Maiden redid that song.
Yes.
Love it.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, next song, Frank. I know I made this kind of difficult. L.A. band, you mentioned the singer a little while ago.
Armored Saint.
There you go.
Joey Vera, dude.
Yes.
When I was a kid, John Alderete and Joey Vera were like our dudes. Yeah. Well, I mean, Steve Harris and Phil Lynott and everybody. But
what was John with Racer X at the time, right? Or was he in a band before that?
No, I mean, we all found him in Racer X. As kids, we would go and see him. And he pretty much set the standard as the players in L.A.
And Joey, amazing.
I mean, Joey Vera, dude. When I was a kid, we would go see. I saw the Ride the Lightning tour, Metallica opening for Armored Saint, March of the Saints tour.
Yeah, the Hollywood Palladium.
Hollywood Palladium.
I was there,
Were you there when Joey Crespo was playing with Adam Bomb and they opened?
Oh, really? I remember Adam Baum, Geffen Records.
They opened that show, and boy, did they get pelted. Yeah. I was just like, Jesus.
Yeah, you don't want to open for Metallica. No. Not especially with a band called Adam Baum.
Wow.
Sorry about that, Adam. Yeah. Are we ready there, Frank? Next song. Let's go. All right. More new wave of British heavy metal for you, Adam. I feel I have to give you hints here.
You know what? This is very familiar. It's just that my brain's not working today. Let me just do it.
Helix.
British thing.
Yeah.
It's not heavy metal love.
Yeah. Heavy petting.
Heavy petting. No, that's a good guess, though. They were Scottish, actually.
Yeah.
A good band.
Yeah.
And that was slightly after the new wave of British heavy metal, really.
Yeah, this was one of the original. Come on. Iron Maiden era.
Priest.
Yeah.
We're running out of time.
Well, I could name them. I'm not familiar with the song. I could name a million bands: Angel Witch, Diamond Head. But just give me
Raven.
Raven, of course. John Gallagher.
There you go. Gallagher.
Yes.
All right. We are closing up. That is our show today. Hey. Thank you very much, Adam Parsons and Robbie Crane. Inside Metal on T Radio V. Thank you so much. Be sure to check out Black Star Writers. BlackStarWriters.com. Right.
Yes,
BlackStarWriters.com. That'll get you everywhere. Everywhere you need to be. New album coming out next week, February 23rd.
23rd in the UK and slightly after in the States.
There you go. Check it out. And what's the title again?
The Killer Instinct.
The Killer Instinct. There you go. Killer Instinct. Thank you for tuning in.
Yeah,
see you next week.
Thank you. Dead witness to an unseen fight. Beat the drum. Be forever on the endless march.
You are watching T Radio V. Radio in TV.